Hi, my name's Andy Campbell. I'm the Global Solution Evangelist here at Financial Force, and I'm delighted to be here today with Matthew. Matthew, could you tell us just something about yourself and what you do at iDocs?
Yeah, of course. So I'm Director Responsible for Professional Services at iDocs. We have a team of about 120 people delivering implementation and customer experience services to a client base across both public and private sector.
iDocs, some organisations or some companies will know sort of who you are and what you do. Could you give us a bit more detail about, you know, who your customers are, something about the size of the organisation, the areas that you specialise in?
Yeah, of course. So we're predominantly about managing workflows where there's an element of regulation. So about half our business is local government, supporting planning, building control, licensing, public protection, environmental health. Mm-hmm. So that ranges from, if you want to put up a conservatory, you'll go through the planning process to make sure it doesn't fall down. You'll go through the building regs process. If you stop off for a kebab on a Friday night, it'll have a food hygiene rating in the window that tells you whether they've got mice in the kitchen or not. Yep. And so we support all of those processes. Within the private sector, we do an awful lot of workflow collaboration with energy and construction. So there, you know, if you're servicing a nuclear power station or building Qatar Airport, as we supported ahead of the World Cup, mm-hmm. you've got lots of organisations that need to be able to access the same documents, review and amend in parallel. So that management of the consultation is critical, and yeah. we provide the software that does that. We do a lot of work in elections, so we supported the Scottish elections in May this year, yep. including the electronic counting of all of the votes. Rather than it being done manually, which is some really good software. We have a health footprint, looking after appointments for sexual health screening. We have some education and social care solutions that look after the statementing process, and again, the interactions between multi-agencies and citizens and the parents. So a lot of it is about, there's a regulatory process and the need to consult, you know, and how do you make sure that software makes consultation as easy as possible, makes collaboration as easy as possible.
So is that the problem that your customers are looking to solve? Is that what they're coming to you for, to help with that collaboration?
I think they start with wanting to be able to tick the regulatory boxes, but then increasingly the collaboration, you know, how do you do it better? You know, there are half a dozen suppliers in the sector. They can probably all tick the regulatory boxes. Mm-hmm. But what's the experience like for both the end users of the system and for the customers as well?
So to some extent, they've looked to get a solution to a problem, and they've actually got a solution that addresses additional problems they didn't even know that they had potentially.
Yeah, certainly area pressure points. Yeah, there's been a lot of focus around, being as flexible as possible in terms of the ways in which you engage. You know, we live in a world where, you know, three clicks on a mobile phone and we can have a book sent to our house, or, you know, we can buy a telly or whatever else. People expect that when they engage with public sector organisations. It's far more complicated to apply for a planning application than it is to buy a book, but people expect that simplicity and engagement route and multi-channel approach. And so, yeah, we're very much about providing that, you know, anytime consumption to the citizens, mm-hmm. based on a firm regulatory framework that supports our core paying customers, being the local authorities or health services.
Interesting that sort of market that you're looking to address. I know you've grown quite a bit over the past few years. You've had, what, three acquisitions this year?
Yes.
So you've been working in professional services for
a
significant
time.
Period of time. Yeah. What to you are the ingredients of success in having a good and robust team?
You've got to be people focused. I think, you know, I can teach you our products, I can teach you our sector, I can't teach attitude. Having a team that care, mm-hmm. that empathize, that understand is really important. And that cuts across all disciplines. So yeah. The consultants clearly have an advantage because they know the business processes. Mm. But yeah, it's important to me that, you know, our technical staff, our data staff, our project managers understand enough of the customer pressure points to be able to empathize, because inevitably when things go wrong, it's understanding the impact of that. So, you know, a 1 week move to the right on your Gantt chart might not feel like much, But if you're doing it just before a key billing cycle or a key licensing renewal cycle, if you're doing it last summer when we had the house tax, I've got what it's called now, stamp duty, holiday, then you know, that's a real pain point for the customer. And they want to feel that you understand the pain and that the solutions that you're putting together take into account what they're going to have. And I think, you know, that's what differentiates between rocking up, telling people how to click the buttons and walking away again, and building a relationship that lasts, you know, a long time. You know, we don't have a lot of churn within our customer base. And that's at least as much about the people and the relationships and the way in which we interact with them as it is about the quality of the products that we provide and the service that we give them.
I'd assume as well that if you understand and you can empathize with the customers in the way that you're suggesting, it also means that you can say, why do you want to do that?
Yes.
And be able to question and provide a different perspective perhaps.
Yeah, absolutely. It was a lessons learned review with a customer a few weeks ago, and they were describing a particular process. And I'm sat there thinking, I've missed something here. I don't understand why you're doing that. I'm always comfortable to ask the daft questions. So I was like, why are you doing it like that rather than like this? And they went, oh, we hadn't thought about doing it like that. Yeah. And in that example, my idea wasn't the right idea either. Yeah. But they had that thought. And I think, you know, increasingly, it's so hard for them to get time to focus on implementation and transformation. You know, they are looking for us to do a little bit of thought leadership to provide some of that challenge for them. So that, you know, they can then, you know, build on what they're doing, you know, within a very pressurized environment. I think, yeah. If you're an inspector on a project team, you know, your day job doesn't stop just because you've been allocated to a project team. So it's quite, you know, kind of staccato in the way in which you end up delivering.
Yeah.
So having people that can give you those trigger points and things to think about is really key. You know, and we've got a very good team, say, across all of the disciplines that think customer, think the way in which they're working, you know, and are happy to provide, you know, advice or questioning.
Yeah, great. So how do you know you're doing a good job? What do you measure across your business and across your professional services domain, you know, to say to yourself, you know, we're performing and here's where the opportunities for greater improvement are?
Yeah. So I guess we do the usual professional services statistics around running projects to budget, staff utilization and those sorts of things.
Yeah.
We have probably more importantly though is around that satisfaction piece. So we created a little hit squad last year for projects that were developing a longer tail than you'd like, and you know, some of them came through escalations, others were, it's a little bit sticky, let's make sure we fix it before there's an escalation. So actually it's the softer measures a lot for me rather than the hard stats. How many complaints do I have at any point in time? What's the relationship with those customers? You know, are we able to turn them around quickly? Are we able to re-establish trust with them? You know, not that it happens a lot, but you know, when I'm in those meetings, you know, I try to be very honest and say, you know, this is the plan. You'll believe it when we deliver on it, not just because I've said about it today. So yeah, you know, I'm accepting the fact that we've got a journey to go through, and it won't be until we, you know, you're starting to see something tangible that you'll start to believe and buy back into us.
So it's not just thinking about the process, it's about the outcomes and translating that potentially into things like net promoter scores and things like that.
So a measure
of customer satisfaction.
Yeah, so we do those scores and you know, both internally and externally, and they're important to us, but they're a point in time, whereas you know, mine's more of a daily pulse points measure. You know, I'm probably directly engaged with 10, 15 customers at the moment, and you know, those weekly, fortnightly calls are the ones where I know whether are we doing things right? Are the improvements that we're making actually delivering? And it's where the reward comes from. Yeah, we've done a couple of process redesigns as a result of customer feedback, and then implemented the new process with them. Yeah, and it's been so well received that you just, that's really good. Yeah, we, You know, we had a problem, we listened, we took advice from the customer in terms of what wasn't working for them. We took advice from our team in terms of what wasn't working for them. Mm. We've put something together and it's worked and it's starting to deliver that better experience.
Brilliant. So what's your relationship then in terms of the professional services team, you know, the people doing work on the ground, with other parts of the organisation? I'm thinking primarily around the sales people at the front of the process, yeah. The finance people at the end of the process. How do you work together?
Pretty well. The sales process we've got pretty well defined. We've effectively got a service catalogue. So unless the customer's after something completely different, the sales team are just pulling down packages, which works really well for them because they can see what they've got. It works really well for us because you don't risk something being sold that you can't deliver.
Yeah, it's that transition, that handover.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And you know, when actually we've done quite a lot of work recently around that handover process, because it is that 2-3% that trips you out. You know, the couple of extra days enhancement to a product that gets missed or that is non-standard. In terms of the finance process, we're in the process of implementing a enhancement to our back-end finance system around sign-offs and proofs. So our governance is very tight. Just because you delivered it, unless the customer confirms that they've had it to their satisfaction, we don't recognise the revenue, which is a very good way of working.
Yeah,
and our management accountants are the gatekeepers to that process. So if they haven't got an email, then they don't sign it off, quite rightly so. So being able to manage that process, we used to do it just one big lump at the end of the month. Mm. We've just implemented something that means it can happen in real time. And I think we hit working day one last month with 96% of the proofs signed off already, whereas historically you'd have had about 20% and then just a big scrimash to try and tidy it up.
Helps your cash flow.
It helps everything. You know, it helps your customer relationships because they're not signing it off. It helps your peer-to-peer relationships because people are able to manage it in their own time. Mm. And cash is important, but you know, if you get the customer service bit right, the cash bit sorts after itself.
So you've touched a couple of times on this concept of the golden record. Just how important is it to sort of have this idea of sort of no integrations, just everything all in one place? I mean, how different is it to run a business with that in place?
It's very important, and actually a lot of what we provide our customers, you know, in a different way is around that one version of the truth, golden record piece. I think, you know, particularly when projects go a little bit off track, the first thing I nearly always end up getting involved in is working out what the issues are. Mm. And I end up with two issues lists, you know. Financial Force PSA will take that away because the entire project will be managed through the collaboration portal.
Yeah.
You know, so unless there's a project failing in terms of the working between the two teams, you know, myself and you know my exec peer on the customer side can go, here we go. Here's our rake.
Yeah.
You know, that we've collectively been feeding into.
Yeah.
So these are the 20 things that, and it would appear that there's, yeah, we've dropped the ball on those five. We need to collectively do a bit better on these five, and you need to do a bit of work on these five. Do we both agree? Because you know, a remediation plan has to be, this is what we're going to focus on. This is how we're going to focus on delivering it. This is how we're going to govern to make sure that it's actually delivering.
Yeah.
Rinse and repeat until you get there.
Yeah.
So it's really important.
The secret for me in running projects is around predictability. You don't want surprises.
Yeah.
And I suppose what you're getting through this shared view that everybody has is no surprises. You know, what's going to be happening, and you can take action before problems take effect.
Yeah. If things didn't go wrong on a project, we wouldn't need project managers.
Yeah.
Project managers, you know, are actually there because there are bumps in the road. You know, people are poorly, a new requirement comes out, something doesn't quite work as it's expected. Mm. And therefore, having that transparency through the project, that shared communication and visibility is absolutely critical. Nobody wants to get surprised on my side or the customer side. So. No,
absolutely. So we talked about the golden record and having these common processes in place. Be good to understand a little bit more about your technology journey. You've invested in Salesforce already and Financial Force as well to go with that. Can you tell us something about what you've deployed and why?
Yeah, of course. So Salesforce has been in the business for at least a couple of years and really revolutionized the visibility of that end-to-end process, a set of tools for the sales team to be able to manage enhanced our ability to govern what we're doing as well. And we have that golden record now in terms of a customer, what they've had, what their renewal points are, and everything else. So what we wanted when we were looking at PSA was something that built upon that, you know, either integrated or in the case of Financial Force PSA, actually sat on top of the same data stack.
No integration.
No integration at all, absolutely. Yeah. Which is really good. So what we're looking at is building that same experience for the professional services team. One version of the truth, shared view of a project. Same for the customer, one view of the truth, ability to update, ability to see, manage the comms all the way through. And just, yeah, we spend a lot of time talking to our customers about how our solutions, you know, join everything up and give them the benefits. And, you know, and this is kind of, you know, us taking our own lessons or our own medicine or whatever. As, you know, they often say that the cobbler's child is the one with the worst shoes. Yeah. So yeah, this is us investing in some serious quality boots.
Absolutely, mate. And you've talked to your customers about the journey and what you're going through as well.
Yeah, overexcited in a couple of meetings and told them about the portal and what that's going to bring and, you know, the advantages. And yeah, they're excited about it as well. I think, you know, it'll be good for those that are in projects, and it'll be a sales differentiator for those that are thinking of joining us.
That's great. So the investment you're putting in Salesforce and Financial Force should act as a platform for the business to support you as you grow and you acquire more businesses moving forward?
Absolutely. You know, like a lot of businesses, you know, we have some processes at the moment that are on spreadsheets. You know, running, you know, a £30 million PS business on a spreadsheet is challenging. It's running a £60 million one is probably impossible. Yeah. So, you know, yeah, we've invested, as the business has done historically, you know, it's pretty good at spotting what it needs to do to go to the next level before it gets there. And the PSA investment was definitely, you know, we're of a size and scale where it's going to be really valuable. But for us to go to the next step, we absolutely have to, you know, have that to be able to grow and support.
That's great. One last question, if I may. So we said at the beginning, you've been in the industry for a fair old time. Yeah. What one piece of advice would you give for organisations, you know, might be slightly smaller than yourselves, about what they should do in order to ensure that they too are able to achieve the kind of growth plans that they might have?
Oh, can I give you two? Customer is spending time with customers is and it's easy to not do the face-to-face now because everyone's got used to Teams. Mm-hmm. So get out there, spend time face-to-face with your customers, not just the ones that are having troubles, but the ones that are happy as well. You know, sit by the side of them, learn what they're doing, understand their businesses is critical. And actually, small businesses are brilliant at that. And as you grow, you start to lose a little bit because everybody gets a bit busy. So try and retain that as you're going through.
That's really interesting.
So, yeah. And I think the other bit is accept the fact that your processes are going to need to change each time you make a step. You know, so that statement of what got you there won't get you to the next level. You know, a £1 million business can cope with things that a £10 million business can't. So again, try and just look at, you know, don't waste money, don't invest too early, but think about, you know, how could I do it if I no longer had Fred who knows everything? Yeah. You know, how would I do it if I couldn't get access to that spreadsheet? Is there a better way or a better process? And I think, you know, you always need to have a view beyond what you're delivering at the moment. And I think, you know, if you can do that, then actually you won't notice that you've changed and evolved because it'll just happen naturally rather than suddenly reaching a point where you go, oh my goodness, I've got a problem now, and you're scrabbling around to fix it.
So that's really interesting. So those two completely different answers, and I see a degree of commonality between them because as you grow, there's some things like the close connection with the customer that you don't want to leave.
Yep.
But where there are other things, might be processes, might be data, whatever, you get to a kind of a tipping point when you're thinking, if we continue on this trajectory, we're not going to be able to do things. Yep. So we have at some point to say, it's not going to be good enough. We do need to make a qualitative change between where we are now and what's going to underpin the business moving forward. So keep good things,
yep.
Don't lose good things, but also be prepared to make the decisions when you need to.
Yeah, we have a saying with our business, don't sleepwalk into something. And I think that's applicable to both. Don't sleepwalk into suddenly discovering you've not been spending as much time with the customers as when you were good. And don't sleepwalk into your systems creaking because you've grown beyond their ability to support.
What a lovely way of summarising it all. Thank you so much. Mathis Holder, thank you so much indeed for joining us today. I hope that you found this webinar of interest and look forward to engaging with you in the future.